You're listening to the audio production of Weed Man, The Remarkable Journey of Jimmy Devine by John McCaslin, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Tim Lundeen. For Lane and Phineas and their crew on Harbor Island. Author's note: this book is based on a true story told for the first time by Jimmy Moree, who lives on a tiny Bahamian island accessible only by boat. Several of the story's characters are identified by their actual names or by nicknames. Identities of others have been changed to protect the guilty. John McCaslin, Washington, D.C., October 2008. Introduction. The sun-baked bottle of Calyx spews suds as Robert Arthur's golf cart, the primary mode of transportation on tiny Harbor Island, spoken Bryland by the locals, bounces along a rough road called Coconut Grove, past the sand dance floor of Gusty's Bar, and onto a crater-filled path leading to the Narrows, a secluded stretch of paradise, where some of the world's wealthiest people try to avoid the rest of us. "You'll enjoy meeting the couple," Robert says as I suck the foam from the beer neck. "Jimmy's Bahamian, a white Bahamian, and Hannah is Canadian. There aren't two nicer people on the island." That was all the tri-tiered baker, realtor, minister bothered to say beforehand about the Morees, although I knew Robert ran with good company. Before he began glazing donuts, peddling properties, and preaching God's word every Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday in his Kingdom Hall, attached to Arthur's Bakery, of Jehovah's Witnesses, the handsome black Bahamian had worked in broadcast journalism, as I did early in my career. During the 1970s, he was splicing tape in the same studio where a budding broadcaster named Lawrence Zeger, better known today as Larry King, hosted a local talk show over Miami television station WTVJ. Like Larry, Robert would rise to become a star in his own right, blessed with one of those one-in-a-million success stories in TV and film, as he describes it. Now he's come back home, to this charming speck of coral floating off the northeast coast of Eleuthera his ancestors helped settle centuries ago. Indeed, despite being raked by an untold number of hurricanes, Harbor Island's colonial-era homes still stand today, lathered in tropical shades of pink, green, and blue, long before Lily Lee Pulitzer painted her house a watermelon sorbet. One 1935 visitor to the island, Nora Benjamin, described a storybook setting for Nassau Literary Magazine. "We found ourselves facing a perfect model of a town, a candy box of a town. There was a coffee-colored house with raspberry shutters, a lemon house with chocolate shutters, a strawberry mousse mansion on the hill, all decorated with white sugar icing. Spotless paved streets and walks ran between gardens, flaming with bougainvillea and hibiscus. Today, the narrow lanes bordered by salt-bleached fences and parjeted walls still bear allegiance to the British crown. King, queen, princess, and pit, to name a few of the streets. In other words, little has changed on the three-mile-long island since the last of the redcoats surrendered the 13 colonies, and the loyalist governor of Virginia fled to this very quay, where he ceremoniously crowned himself Lord Dunmore. Ironically, of all the West Indies in the California-sized archipelago to choose from, Lord Dunmore evacuated to one inhabited by a religious flock that first landed in 1647 to escape persecution in England. He immediately ordered their subsequent generations expelled, and only then was he able to christen the British Empire's newest capital. What else? Dunmore Town. In fact, after he baked his final dozen donuts one day, Robert put on his real estate hat and arranged for my family to buy a 200-year-old colonial, pink with blue-green shutters, directly next door to the original site of Lord Dunmore's cottage on Crown Street. "What's the name of Jimmy's wife again?" "Hannah. She keeps a beautiful home, as you'll see," says Robert, maneuvering his backfiring ride along a bumpier stretch that leads to Harbor Island's world-famous Pink Sand Beach, where shapely Elle McPherson has struck some of her finest poses. "Oh, and Jimmy doesn't drink," adds Robert, watching as I pry my sticky fingers from the beer bottle. "Lovely," I think to myself, wishing suddenly that I hadn't accepted the baker's invitation to meet some locals, which I assumed required climbing out of my bathing trunks and into the one pair of decent pants I generally pack, in case the President of the United States bombs Iran and cuts my vacation short. A virtual canopy of flowering trees and coconut palms shades our way to the couple's lovely house, built tall on concealed pilings and tucked behind thick dunes of sand. Robert parks his cart near the sweeping set of front steps, where, awaiting our arrival, is the barefoot Hannah, who, I learn later, was born in Toronto, went to art school in Nova Scotia, owned a horse farm with her first husband in Ontario, and sold real estate in New Orleans, before meeting Jimmy during her vacation and subsequently marrying him. My reputation precedes me, as the strawberry blonde hostess is anxious to hear the latest political news from Washington. Is George W. Bush's surge really working? Who is this Barack Obama fellow? Has Bill Clinton calmed down any? Like Hannah, Jimmy is a gracious host. Relaxed in shorts, Lacoste polo, and cement-splashed Crocs, which he sheds at the front door, so much for my urban threads, he sports a healthy head of jet-black hair with matching goatee, and is amazingly fit for somebody his age, which I guess to be mid-50s. He credits the carpentry trade, which he first learned as a teenager, for being in such good shape. Although I come to find out he was once the top-ranked kickboxer in all of the Bahamas. He briefly explains the history behind his small construction and renovation business, preferably one house at a time, given that he's semi-retired. Just that morning, in fact, he and his crew of carpenters set out to save a termite-consumed colonial at the corner of King and Princess Streets, although he hinted the prognosis was not good. As Robert and Hannah weigh the latest Harbor Island gossip, what Bahamians call sip-sip, Jimmy serves everybody mixed drinks or wine, pouring himself one of those trendy lemon-lime sodas imported from Europe with the red star on the side. Soon, he chimes in more and more, until such time he's the captivating master of ceremonies. For the next 2 hours, I can't believe what I'm hearing. I sit on a kitchen bar stool as Jimmy spins one amazing yarn after another in a lilting Bahamian accent, unlike any I've ever heard cross the lips of a white man. He recalls growing up on Long Island, just due west of San Salvador, where Christopher Columbus dropped anchor and first set foot in the New World. I hadn't known it, but Long Island was the Italian explorer's third discovery, the second being pint-sized rum cake. Jimmy explains how his mother, Perlene, took to her bed after his delivery. "I weighed almost 14 pounds," he reasons. And as a result, he was bundled up in his baby blanket and sent by mail boat to the Bahamian capital of Nassau, where he would live with his father's sister, Olive, a big-boned, outwardly religious woman who, besides her own strict guiding principles, relied on the black preachers from the Church of God and the white nuns from the Catholic school to teach Jimmy right from wrong. He relives the summers he spent on Long Island with his father, Jacob, helping farm, fish, and ferry spices between the various islands, including Cuba. I hear of his unrehearsed Hollywood acting roles, a childhood part in the original Flipper, as well as a speedboat racer alongside James Bond. He tells of his first marriage, which coincided with his first business venture, as a scuba diving instructor off the coast of Abaco, the Bahamian island due north of here. It was on that secluded quay, one otherwise ordinary morning, that the health-conscious Jimmy went for his usual jog on the beach, one that changed his life forever. After all, how many people stumble upon several million dollars when they're out exercising? Soon, millions more dollars would fall into his lap. And with each million, Jimmy has an incredible story to tell, the next one more amazing than the last, all recalled in his sweet-flowing Conchi Joe, slang for minority white Bahamians, accent I never grow tired of hearing. One minute my jaw is agape, like when he describes the view from his pew at the royal wedding of Prince Charles and Lady Diana. And the next I'm laughing myself to tears when he's a child again, trying to poison his crusty old neighbor with a deadly barracuda. I wipe away real tears when he recounts the times he would return to Long Island and pay back the poor families of farmers and fishermen who helped care for his ailing mother when he couldn't. He'd given each family two envelopes, one for the wife and one for the husband, containing more money than they would ever see from a bumper year of potatoes and lobsters. By the time he pours my third or fourth Mount Gay rum, one great thing about Harbor Island is a person forgets how to count, I can't help but realize Jimmy never bothered to mention what it was he stumbled upon on the beach that otherwise ordinary morning that changed his life so drastically. So I ask him. He suddenly becomes quiet and looks to Hannah, who turns and looks to Robert, who turns to look my way. On cue, I look back at Jimmy. "Should I tell him?" he asks. Chapter 1. Rusted wheels clung to worn tracks as the rickety train climbed the savanna, or high plateau of the Andes Mountains. Slouched so as to be less noticed in the passenger seat nearest the locomotive, the Reverend Jerome Constantakis felt inside his scarlet-red tunic for his passport, which identified him as a Catholic priest from the Bahamas. Proof of citizenship and motley vestments wouldn't be required once he reached his final destination in the Sierra Nevada de Santa Marta, the world's highest coastal mountain range he'd soon be ascending on the back of a donkey, the day's final mode of transportation that began in the back seat of a Miami taxi. He zipped his travel documents into a small suitcase kept at his feet, where he could feel it, realizing in doing so that he forgot his toothbrush again. Father Jerome, as he called himself, for fear of butchering the last name, had never grown comfortable administering blessings to the appreciative Colombians who squatted in the mountainous villages between Bogota and the northern coast. Seldom did these peasants come face to face with visiting clergymen of his caliber, dressed to the hilt and sporting an ecclesiastical stone ring so gigantic it should have belonged to the pontiff. "Full regalia," he now describes the wardrobe with its dangling tassels and trinkets. "Sometimes I wore purple, sometimes I wore red. I didn't wear just the black outfit with white collar. I didn't have the Pope's hat, but I had the Cardinal's hat." Mothers and grandmothers alike, babies forever glued to their arms, swarmed around the handsome priest with the jet-black hair and matching goatee. "Padre, bendiga a mi baby, por favor," they pleaded, asking for blessings for their children. Father Jerome managed a smile with each request, grateful when the women extended the infants so he wasn't at a loss for their requests. He then placed the palms of his sun-tanned hands atop each silky scalp and recited his trademark Latin blessing, a few holy words he could recall from his years as an altar boy in 1960s Nassau, at which point the unsuspecting Colombians, who spoke Castilian Spanish, peppered with Colombian vernacular, or one of 180 other indigenous languages overheard in the third world country, knelt down before the holy impostor to kiss the magnificent ring. Without fail, Father Jerome followed each Latin blessing with a separate prayer that he whispered to himself in a language he could understand. "God forgive me," he repeated over and over again. More often than not, his mind turned to the real Father Jerome, his principal at Sacred Heart Catholic School in Nassau, and a guiding force in his life. How would that servant of the Lord, a Pennsylvanian from blue-collar Bethlehem, have reacted if he'd known that one of his more promising non-Catholic altar boys and pupils had literally hijacked his name and most sacred vow? The guilt would have been unbearable had the phony priest not recalled the strap. Once the unruly boys had grown taller than the nuns, Father Jerome would be summoned to administer more memorable punishments. The children called it strap time, when they would bend over their desks for lashings, the specific number hinging on the severity of the crime. "So what if I'm not an ordained channel to God?" Father Jerome reasoned with himself. "Isn't my presence alone a good thing? Aren't my prayers and blessings among these masses of spiritually deprived people better than having none at all?" He recalled one of his former Sacred Heart classmates, whose surname was Constantakis. The boy had been enrolled in the Catholic school for maybe a year before his Greek parents shipped him off to boarding school. It took one of his classmates so long to memorize his name that he hadn't forgotten it to this day. Still, it was difficult for him to pronounce. And then the school's stern principal popped back into his mind, haunting him again. "Pour the wine," the principal would encourage his timid altar server, who would start to pour and then stop, the chalice half full. Maybe it was because he'd grown up knowing that too much alcohol, whether orange-colored altar wine or the clear hooch his father drank, was not such a good thing. "More wine, more wine. It's okay, Jimmy." No, it wasn't the Colombian police or military that Father Jerome dreaded bumping into during his risky journeys into these unfamiliar mountains. He wasn't afraid of the rebel groups that kidnapped foreigners for a living, holding them for ransom. What petrified him more than anything else was crossing paths with a Catholic priest or a nun and having to lie about being in the poor South American country in hopes of opening an orphanage. It was a tough sell to begin with.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.